Good afternoon. We're going now to start. Welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to be sitting here with all of you and all of you. My name is Andrea Bernal. I'm a journalist, and I work for RCN News in Colombia and NTN24 in Latin America. What brings us together is the fourth industrial revolution, and I want to just make a little bit of context to that. The first industrial revolution used water and steam power to mechanize production. The second used electric power to create mass production. The third used electronics and information technology to automate production. Now, a fourth revolution that is building on this third, the digital revolution, that has been occurring since the middle of the last century and is characterized by a fusion of technologies that is blurring the lines between the physical, the digital, and biological spheres. Klaus Shaw, Professor Shaw, in his publication, The Fourth Industrial Revolution, states that we are at the beginning of a revolution that is changing the way we live, the way we work, the way we relate to each other. And what he considers to be the fourth industrial revolution is unlike anything humankind has experienced before. With that powerful statement, I want to introduce my panelists today. Brian Gallagher, from President and Chief Executive Officer, United Way Worldwide, from the United States. Claudia Vasquez, President and General Manager, Latin America, from CA Technologies, Colombia. Claudia, Brian, welcome. Is also here with us, David Luna Sánchez, Ministro de Tecnologías de la Información y las Comunicaciones de Colombia. David, bienvenido.
Oye, qué carrera la que hizo David Luna, ¿no?
President of Customer Success, Renewals, and Latin America Salesforce. Maria, welcome. And Ildefonso Guajardo Villarreal, Secretary of the Economy of Mexico. Con este lujo de panelistas, luxury I have here, I want to start with an open question to everyone, because we are asking, well, what is the fourth industrial revolution? When did it start? It already started. How is Latin America ready to embrace it? And from your different areas, Ildefonso, I'll start with you. How do you define this emerging revolution, and what are the principles difference between the third one and what we are expecting? Welcome.
Thank you. Well, first of all, one thing that is happening is that when we are, you call the world fusion, what happens is that different technologies are converging at the same time to transform how we do things and how we respond to the market. One of the elements that you are looking into here is that now the management of big data is giving you information that can be directly used by the production process and translated in the way things interact with each other, the Internet of Things, to design the new process. Just in time was part of the third revolution. This one, the market is directly sending signals to the production process. You are going out from mass production to specialized markets with high value added, which is definitely the challenge. But now let me bring a point into this process. This morning we have a discussion with a very intelligent group of people, one of them the director, a Colombian director of the Inter-American Development Bank, and he said, what can we do in Latin America to try to see that the next really entrepreneurs that are putting new platforms, new innovations, are called Martinez, Sanchez, or with the Spanish last names? I say they are already called Martinez and Sanchez. The difference is that capital markets in Latin America are not really financing the bright ideas that are migrating to Silicon Valley by Hispanic entrepreneurs that are being very successful in North American markets. So we have to really start taking the challenge and how we can do a good environment in Latin America to support these new talents.
Thanks, Ildefonso. Maria, from your perspective, how do you see this emerging revolution principal difference with computers, with technologies, with smartphones?
Well, thank you, Andrea, and it's really a pleasure to be here. Let me say that certainly we at Salesforce feel like we're part, you know, of this revolution, and it's in the making. So it's a very exciting time, you know, for all of us. In Salesforce, We build, you know, CRM, you know, customer relationship management software in the cloud. And we have been a pioneer of cloud technologies, which are a key big part of this revolution. And with that, we've of course seen tremendous growth that we're clearly, you know, very excited about, you know, for the company. And with our platform, you know, we're actually capitalizing a lot of these things. In particular, for us, the key element is that we believe we are in the age of the customer. And the customer today, because there is so much information, so much connectivity, so much access of things that came from the third revolution, that now the customer, and the customer being, if you're a company, it could be the consumer, if you're a government, it's your citizen, we all have customers. The customer is empowered more than ever before to be in charge, to demand more from companies and from institutions, to deliver a better experience, you know, to do a lot more for them. So we think that this is clearly key. I mean, I talk to a lot of CEOs here in Latin America, and I hear constantly a fear of being Uberized, right? You know, I'm afraid that someone in my sector is gonna come like Uber and deliver a much better, you know, user experience for my customers that is going to, you know, take advantage of this massive, you know, disruption that technology can create. And really, you know, change, you know, what we are. So really, for us, that is the real key element of the fourth revolution.
David, from the government, how do you see this wave coming, and how are you preparing policies to redefine this fourth industrial revolution country from what you expected from the third?
Vivimos claramente.
We clearly live in a stage where commodities, where the prices of oil were at their best in Latin America, and particularly in Colombia. We are living a different moment in the economy, and the boom of the digital economy, therefore, is a great opportunity. We in the government understand it as going from consumer internet to production internet. And let me answer with a mere example. Only a few months ago, President Sánchez's administration made the decision of digitalizing the fishing activity in Colombia. And the fishermen in different areas of the country do not only have a tablet, but also a software that enables them to match the currents and climate. They, therefore, go out to fish less days, and they fish more. So we are trying to really harness these opportunities in different sectors, in health, in education, in tourism, in agriculture. And that is where we believe there is a great opportunity for the government. Colombia made the decision of creating a legislation. This was some years ago already, which allows the digital competition to be healthy and to offer guarantees. But additional to this, President Santos' administration made a decision that was criticized at that time, but now it is a source of congratulation, the building of infrastructure to take on the big challenges. And that is where we are going to have a competitive advantage that we'd like to share with the other members of Latin America. Professor Raul Katz, only a week ago or a few weeks ago, produced a very important digital economy index. And it says that in finances, in health and education, Colombia is going along the right path. The challenges are in the trade and manufacturing sectors that are surely resisting joining that digital economy because of idiosyncrasy. And that is clearly where we have a huge opportunity to harness. And then we will talk about services. Maria mentioned it. She mentioned Uber, the new apps, how the governments are including all this into their policies.
We agree that this fourth industrial revolution has not emerged yet. Do we agree on that? First, so if it doesn't come yet, we have an opportunity to shape it. and that's the interesting part. What do we want for the region, Claudia? What would you want to see from your business and then political perspective from others to see in Latin America this fourth revolution?
Thank you, Andrea. Well, yes, I fully agree it is emerging right now, but I would say that is also a reality today. I mean, the fourth industrial revolution is already here and it's gonna stay, and we need to get ready for it and understand the challenges and the opportunities we have for Latin America. If we think on the fourth industrial revolution, it is all about hyperconnectivity, as we were talking, being very social. But what I think is most important, it is that it's centered on people. So consumer is the center of the industrial revolution. And if we check or if we review what has been already done with, for example, Uber and others, mm-hmm. we will see that, I mean, the ideas came from consumers, because we need to understand what they need. And if we think in Latin America, we have several companies that already understand that they need to listen to the consumers, and in some cases they do. The problem we have right now is we don't go fast and don't execute in what needs to be done to transform those requests or demands into real solutions right now. So that is what we need to be thinking now. We need to build an agile society for Latin America based in our perspective, because CA Technologies is a software company. So we need to build it based on agile systems and agile technologies. And agile is a major word right now, because it is key to eliminate the barriers between ideas and results. So we need to be thinking agile for LATAM. We need to be ready to take the risk and understand. It brings a world of opportunities for LA. I think knowledge sharing is probably the most important characteristic of the fourth industrial revolution. And it brings a difference because everyone is able today to access information fast and with quality, something that in the past was not possible in our countries for everyone. So that's something we need to take seriously in LATAM.
Brian, Professor Shaw, in his publication, I want to cite him again. He says, anything humankind has experienced before, and I see it so powerful because, yes, it's emerging, but as Claudia says, it's here. Then, what changes should these new technologies and systems bring to the region? But what do we not want to be changed? What should stay the same? What has worked in the region?
Well, let me maybe turn the second question around to say, I've been doing this work long enough to say wanting things not to change doesn't work. Fact is, the two biggest drivers in our world, raising money for human services and then deciding where to invest in human services right now in the world, are the movement of people. There's more people living outside their country of birth than any time in the history of the world. And the second is digital technology and the advancement of digital technology. And the way I think about it is digital technology, among other things, moves us from being a vertical society and a centralized society to a horizontal and decentralized society. So if you're thinking about customers or voters or people who need services from nonprofit organizations, it's you don't need the middleman. So I've made this analogy before that didn't always, some elected officials didn't like it, but I think it's a powerful analogy in addition to business. Representative democracy. The idea was a vertical value chain, that I would elect my local representative who would go to the next level of government and represent my interests. Well, maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe I can instead, using technology, associate with people who might have the same point of view, and we'll go around our local elected officials to go to the top. So I would say this, for the region, investment in education, especially early childhood education, and creating access to technology. That's what will create the competitive advantage for the region going forward.
Ildefonso?
I think that Brian mm-hmm. is right in his example, when he uses the example of representation. I think that what we are looking in the U.S. election is exactly consumers going directly to what they think is the best solution.
Exactly right. Amen. You know what? They're not always right.
It doesn't mean they're right.
They have the power. They're not always
you
right.
You talk, Brian, and I want to translate this question to Ildefonso about a vertical society. Do you mean also about more or less inequality? Do you talk about that also when you mean a vertical society? Because I want to enter there. The possible impacts that we have already with the third revolution and with what we see now, that it has yielded greater inequality.
In some places. In, you know, globalization and computerization, technology has lifted hundreds of millions of people out of abject poverty. It's created inequality in some developed markets, for sure, like the U.S. and other places. But I think it was disruptive, for sure. And this technology, I think, has the very likely possibility of being even more disruptive. And so that's why I'll just say, and to President Santos and the Colombian leadership, providing or guaranteeing universal access for early childhood education throughout the country is the smartest investment a government can make. Mm-hmm. A child's brain will be 85% developed by age 3. And so if in the fourth industrial revolution, value is going to be created by ideas and knowledge, and if you start early and then keep children in school and then graduate from university, that will be your advantage. That's how you deal with inequality, I think.
Ildefonso.
I think that the question of lagging and inequality is even in the historical terms. Mm-hmm. The first and second industrial revolution, it required a catch-up of nations that took 100 years. I mean, after the English industrial revolution, some underdeveloped countries have taken for a long time to catch up. One of the challenges and the advantages that this technological breakthrough brings is the possibility that Latin American countries, if they have the right set of policies, the catch-up time can be shortened. And the way you can use technologies themselves to really try to close the gap through investment in education, in the case of Mexico with educational reform, obviously, it is very clear in Mexico the quality of education is differential even in the public sector. I was born in the north. I'm the result of public education of my life. If I had been born in the state of Oaxaca, I could not be where I am today because of the difference in quality given the difference in the interaction of the unions. So preserving education and the right to a good quality education is fundamental. Now, let me go back to your question about the responsibility of governments. Mm-hmm. We cannot fool ourselves. In order to really have access to the fourth industrial revolution, we have to do homeworks that are elemental. Markets have to work. Therefore, a very strong antitrust law has to be in place. If there are concentrations, like in the case of Mexico, there were concentrations in telecommunications, access to internet and access to competitive technologies is not there. And therefore, innovation is not part of the system. So you have to have strong antitrust laws. You have very strong laws that really make financial markets to work. Because again, if you don't have financing for bright ideas, there is nothing to be really looking forward in terms of the brains that we are developing in our continent. Therefore, even regulation, trying to simplify the way we regulate business is a fundamental thing. I mean, in Mexico, just to give you an example, for the first time in Mexican history, this year, finally, we approved a law that you can create a business from your computer without going to a public office for small and medium-sized entrepreneurs, so far that you can just use your computer, open your business, satisfy the requirements that are in line. You don't have to pay, like they used to, a public notary, mm-hmm. about $500, which will make it impossible for a young entrepreneur to open a business. So to facilitate life, to create competitive markets is a fundamental homework that governments have to do to really be ready to launch any new initiative.
Maria, yes, David, and then I'll talk with Maria.
A very important thing regarding what has been said, while in Latin America, the venture risk capitals invest in startups, invest $15 per capita. They're investing between 400 and 500. And in Israel, they invest more than $800 per capita. What does that mean? It means that we, evidently, as a region, have an opportunity, first of all, to call the attention of the business community. That is why, in the case of Colombia, the government is trying hard to invest an important part of the GDP in research. Our director of Colciencias is here, and it is the hard work between the private sector, the public sector, and of course the academia is very important, because the idea is that technology and research, big data, may be developed into training processes. And this hand in hand with a problem that exists not only in this continent, but in the rest of the world. And it is that the new generations do not want to go to school for technology-associated careers, IT, software, computing. And the biggest challenge is not only not to get them to fall in love with technology again, but to get them to understand that there is a huge opportunity for them from the structural point of view. I mention this basically because for the government, the joint work with the private sector in education, in research, is a key piece in order to set a goal regarding the digitalization of the economy. And how to
lack of opportunities. Universities are not ready for putting on the table those kinds of careers.
It's a process. It's a process. We work on a permanent basis with the universities to get them to modify their syllabuses. Many times they are obsolete, outdated. We work with the schools, we work with the students. But as you were well saying, we have a huge challenge in math, in science, in those types of initiatives, because we can live in a digital economy. We may have the public funds and resources, but if the talent, the skill is not well trained from the base in order to take on that challenge, we will be left behind. And that is where the big opportunity lies.
We all have a responsibility, private sector and public sector, in order to make sure that young people understand that then IT today is more than development, because people used to relate IT with development only. And the reality is, today, IT is an enabler, and it goes directly to the business, and it's responsible for time to market reduction, for increasing customer loyalty, and many other important things. So we need to work and rebrand the way we sell this to our young people, because they keep forgetting that. And also, we need to make everyone understand that in the second and third industrial revolution, people needed to be physically there in order to perform a job. Mm-hmm. Today, with the fourth industrial revolution, you don't need to be there. You can do the same work remotely without any issue, because, again, technology enables that. So it is very important for us to work together on it.
Brian, and then we jump to another.
I'll say very quickly, this point about how there's a lag in terms of the social response to economic transformation, absolutely true, always happened. After industrialization, the computer age, I think the difference today is we don't have the luxury of time, that the business cycles are so fast, the media cycles so fast, that so we could take 100 years after industrialization to figure out how to close the inequality gap, and the computer age, 20 years to close the we don't have that luxury anymore. And so our education systems and our healthcare systems and our public systems and nonprofit systems need to embrace the digital technology and this technology generally, and that's going to create significant change that the inertia within institutions will resist. You know, individual learning on behalf of students as young as primary school instead of a regimented curriculum that is taught vertically, it'll be too slow because the world's moving so much faster today.
Murray, is this for the Industrial Revolution for a few? Why I ask this? Because today, those who have gained the most from the digital era have been consumers that have been able to afford it and access to it. If yes, if you agree with that, what do you think should be done to add other segments of the population so they do not get excluded? Half of the population of Latin America still do not have access to internet. So, and now we are talking about a fourth industrial revolution. So it's about a few?
Yeah. Well, I think there's got to be the commitment. It's got to be that digital technologies need to be available to everyone. Mm-hmm. And I actually believe that there are a lot of things happening, and there are good indicators that are showing that we're making progress. I was very encouraged by the comments from President Santos this morning, and I know a lot of commitments from Brazil and Mexico about making digital technologies available, making internet available. I understand that even by next year, it's likely that 75% of all the households in Latin America will have internet. We're seeing growth in Latin America faster in adoptions of certain technologies. Including public cloud services, actually Latin America is growing faster than even Europe and Asia. So I think that this region has a good opportunity to leapfrog some of the legacy investments that have made. And as you said, a point I want to emphasize is that it's not only for consumers, it's got to be for the businesses. And many businesses have invested over the years on legacy systems, right? They spend a lot of money on them to replace business processes, and we all realize good efficiencies, but the current legacy systems are not ready to really capitalize on the age of the customer, really, right? They are built for the last industrial revolution, and they need to be modernized, and the businesses that invest in modernizing are going to be the ones that are going to be able to compete and win. And I know that, we always talk about that this region has economic challenges, but if you think about it, my view is that every business needs to plan to invest in these areas, otherwise they're going to be left behind.
Ildefonso,
because I think that your question goes to the point of winners and losers of change. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very relevant because it's giving us a question about sustainability of change. And if we look at what is going on in the United States, there is a big chunk of population that was raised up to believe of a permanent job in their lifetime in the manufacturing sector. And all of a sudden, there is a very big demographic, white, Anglo-Saxon, middle-aged men that feel that the system has not been good to them. And here you have a lot of jobs because of technological development, and the winners are in the digital area, but they are, by definition, entrepreneurs, individualists. But then the 20th century was built on corporate behavior, unions, chambers, and there is this clash of two generations where I think that governments have a big responsibility on how to make these benefits of change really be widespread in society. Because if that does not happen, then the obstacles for change are going to be there. And we have to be very aware of that.
Ildefonso, you touched the next topic, employment. In this fourth industrial revolution exists the risk that automation will be substituting hand labor, which derive to the loss of employment. That's one of the fears of the this fourth industrial revolution, the loss of employment. Is the private, in your case, public sector, governments prepared for that? How would you be assuming this challenge that is in a way a fact?
Yes, in the book that you were referring to, mm-hmm. by Dr. Schwab, 2/3 of the kids in primary school today will have jobs that do not exist. And that's the challenge for public policies, mm-hmm. how to do skills that will need to prepare the new generation for new challenges. So if you look at the US case, when you disintegrate the value of a smartphone, and when you claim that a lot of jobs have gone to China, when you see the value of a smartphone, at the end of the day, it's design, it's technology, it's value added, and 80% of that value is paid in the US. So the high pay value jobs in technology have to be really widespread, and you have to really disseminate these new challenges. The other day I was talking to former mayor of New York, Bloomberg, and he was saying, we cannot resist change. Mm-hmm. Things are going to happen. What we have to vision is how we are going to respond to new quality, to new jobs, to increase the quality of life. How can you really expand the service sector to accommodate new needs of a generation that is in a different stage of quality of life? So we have to have enough capacity to widespread the new trend in services to give human race better quality of life. We don't have to be tied to the machine, to the production line to really expect the creation of more jobs in the traditional way. But there are new jobs to be developed to increase quality of life.
Jobs that do not exist, that like says Ildefonso Maria, or jobs that or there are not going to be jobs.
No, I think that there are going to be a lot of jobs. The jobs we need to upskill the workforce, basically, right? So if you think about, we've gone through transitions like that, in the past. In the 1900s in the U.S., 40% of the workforce was working in agriculture. Mm-hmm. And today, it's less than 2%. And it's not that is not an industry that is not successful for the U.S., right? So I think we need to think about the jobs that are going to be needed in the future and prepare the workforce for the jobs of the future, which are going to be higher skills. Today, I can tell you that one of the obstacles for growth for us in Salesforce is access to talent today. So there's jobs today, but there's a mismatch, between people that don't have jobs and jobs that are needed.
David.
I think that to answer your question, there is a very complex problem that we are going to have to solve between all of us, which is the rigidity of the academic system. The academic system has had enormous difficulty to certify skills, to certify capacities, to certify many enablers that hundreds of millions of people possess today, but that they are unable to put into practice, to sell in the marketplace. A few days ago, our Minister of Education made the decision to start to find ways to start to certify those existing skills that the traditional educational system had never been able to. I'm not saying that this is the only step that needs to be taken, but it's a very interesting option because the industry, especially the industry associated to technology, to communications, is constantly requesting talent, not only trained talent, but also people who have very specific skills. And oftentimes colleges and universities and entrepreneurship centers or training centers are not sufficiently, don't have the capacity to deliver these to industry. So it's a problem that can become an opportunity. And this morning, President Santos said that the Chinese are always look for the opportunity hidden in the crisis. And I think that in Latin America, we have a great opportunity that is posed by the very problem that you suggest, which is that the digital economy or the new era will likely destroy many jobs, but it will also be ready to create new ones if we are able, from the government and from the academia, to deliver those capacities that are currently required and that already exist and need to be certified.
I think nobody knows whether this new revolution is going to create more jobs than kill, but it's going to change them. And the story in the United States is the story in France, in Japan, in the UK. It's the carving out of the middle class, And it's not that there isn't, that there aren't jobs and that there isn't even GDP growth, but personal income on an average has not increased in the United States for 30 years. And so the fact is that the disruption has been faster than the education systems and the employers have been to recreate the inclusive solution. So that I think what we have to be wary of is not the concentration of wealth. You know, I rail against that when people will say to me, well, you work in nonprofit, you must not like concentration of wealth. I love a strong marketplace. I love rich people, as long as it's not a concentration of power and access. Because then that, so populist policy is different than people-centered policy. And that's what has to change faster. The fact is our education systems and other systems are going to have to create access. What's lost in America today is mobility. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, it goes all the way, and we don't have leadership in the United States that's willing to take on fundamental tax reform, take on immigration, take on adaptation at a big scale. And unless leaders do that, it doesn't matter what companies and nonprofits do. That's, I think, the story of the U.S. right now.
Ahora, quiero volver a David.
I want to go back to David to talk about the Colombian case. I know that Mexico and Uruguay has a new legislation, but what I'm heading at is that this fourth industrial revolution is moving faster than any of the previous ones, like a couple of you have said. And we very well know that governments take time to make decisions, to draft legislation, and to, in fact, change things. And I want to know how David in Colombia, and we'll talk about Mexico later, because President Tabarebas in Uruguay has said that we need to regulate Netflix, Airbnb, Uber, just to mention a few apps that in Latin America have so many governments sort of out of sorts. And they've been unable to regulate them on the one hand, and they are moving toward prohibition almost. So how does that look when governments are trying to close the doors to things that, as Brian says, are already here? Technology goes a lot faster than legislation. We agree on that. And that is not only proven, but doubly proven. Isn't there a way to allow them to go roughly at the same pace? Can't we lend a hand to legislators? Well, I don't know if there is a way, but President Santos points out that the marketplace as much as possible and the state as much as necessary. That has a very clear meaning, which is that the focus must be the citizen, must be service. It must be whatever benefits our everyday lives. And like many other countries, we are immersed in immense debates. And these debates obviously end up resolving themselves insofar as citizens have the possibility not only to choose the best service, but where the industry has, companies have the capacity to compete among them. So what governments, in our case, are constantly told is that we shouldn't regulate more, but deregulate. We should offer the possibility for companies to play in a level playing field. Many people here, one that may not be here that you know better than us, is the case of television. In the case of television, there are still these old legacy legislations that haven't been updated for a long time. So beyond the question of whether or not to tax Netflix, we need to rethink the system. How can we make them compete on an equal footing? And for that reason, governments, at least in the case of Colombia, the decisions that the government makes are, in fact, aiming to always protect the consumer, to protect the user, obviously without causing harm or legal insecurity to investors and entrepreneurs.
Is to Netflix or to Uber, that means that the governments were not ready for that. I mean, they came in, consumers need it, and now they don't know what to do with that.
I think, I mean, the reality is regulations need to be able to allow the users to feel secure. And but what is very important for governments, in my opinion, is to understand that there are many different types of consumers today. I mean, we will always have consumers that will prefer to take a cab on the street. But then you have another type of consumers that are thinking about risk. And if they are thinking about risk, they would prefer to pay a differential price in order to get what gets them home in the way they want it. So in my opinion, it is a matter of understanding that with the technology we have today, there's no way stopping. There's no way to stop in that. I mean, that is not going to uh-huh. stop. And as I said, technology enables that. And what we need to do is to make sure that it is done in a secure way for consumers and that governments rethink the way we apply regulations today in order to allow the business to be located in the segment it wants to be located.
Ildefonso.
Let me, Brian had a phrase that is a lovely one. It's not the same populist policies than people-centered policies. Uh-huh. With that, I can forecast your vote in the U.S. election. But let me go back specifically to the point about innovation and the way markets evolve and the way public sector reacts. I do believe that I agree with David. I think that, you cannot go against the wave. Mm-hmm. Once Uber, B&B appear, what you have to do is how you disrupt the traditional corporate structure of taxi drivers and the supply of rooms in the hotel market, because you have to respond with a way to deregulate the way of usual business, of business as usual, and really allow them to compete with the new wave of new business platforms that you have to allow them to compete. What is happening today is we have a resistance. And there is this corporate interest that is fighting against innovation. But you have to facilitate the process in which they can coexist and the way they really can live together. Because otherwise, you will not have a stable system to cooperate in this regard. But at the same time, I do believe that the public sector has the big responsibility of designing the legal framework and the regulatory framework that will facilitate things to happen. Resistance, you cannot avoid the wave of change.
Mm-hmm. Almost an hour has gone through. I have like 15 or around 10 minutes for Q&As from the audience, but I want to finish really fast with a conclusion. With your perspective, let's start with you and finish with Brian. What is humanity facing and what are the risks and opportunities? One risk, one opportunity.
I do believe that humanity is facing the opportunity to really take advantage of an exponential change that can bring benefit to human beings. I think that by implementing in the most practical way what is happening and trying to give social sustainability of change is important. The risk, the big risk, we are going through very troubled waters. Mm-hmm. I do believe that there is a big portions of the world population that are unsatisfied with results. Mm-hmm. They are challenging the systems, they are challenging governments and institutions. Spain has been struggling for a year to get the presidency. Austria is going through very rough times in a very conflict political definition. Brazil ousted a president. The US is going to one of the most complex elections in history. So you go around the world and there is very bad social humor around the world. So there is a big challenge how to respond to that feeling. And people have causes why they feel like they feel, but you have to be able to really respond with new instruments to really satisfy what people is demanding today.
Maria, risk and opportunities.
Well, I think we have an amazing opportunity to embrace, you know, the age of the customer. And I think that the amazing change that is happening, I think it's going to take for the government and the companies to work together in collaboration around topics like education, infrastructure upgrades, and being ready. And I think that the the groups of the countries, the cities that embrace this opportunity are the ones that are going to really be able to capitalize. And clearly, the digital technologies provide the opportunity for really reaching out, you know, every citizen, if we can address the education and infrastructure issues.
David.
I think that the biggest risk is that of creating confidence in the consumer. And what do I mean by this? I mean that consumers have to be at ease. They have to be confident that the changes are still safe, that they can sleep in peace. And countries in Latin America and all over the world have to work strongly in their digital safety and digital security public policies, because otherwise, yes, we are facing a great opportunity, but very few people will believe in it, and we may miss the train. So that risk, and that is how I see the risk, becomes in turn into an opportunity. And we have the responsibility to provide to the private sector, from the public sector, and for consumers, the possibility of creating an outlook that is safe and that is alert to dangers.
I'm going to answer from an enterprise perspective. I think the biggest risk for companies today in Latin America is not to understand fast enough that they need to change and that they need to be innovative and really start understanding the new way of thinking of the consumers. And it is quite an opportunity for them to adopt new technologies like DevOps and agile methodologies to really start delivering new businesses to consumers. And I think LATAM can set the pace on that globally if we really start doing it.
Right.
I think the great opportunity is that we're moving into the era of the individual. So as an enterprise, you would say era of the customer. I think it's era of the individual, which brings down cost and barrier as it relates to opportunity. And so that's a very good thing. The other thing it does, and this goes to the risk, is that everything is global and everything is instantaneous. Everyone has access to the same information by and large at the same time. And the big risk is that our institutions, and I'm not just talking about governments, but all institutions will be too slow to change, to either regulate, monitor, provide security, whatever it is, because the world in this era of individuals is going to go much faster than we go.
Privacy, another fear. There are some tweets people have been tweeting. If you help me with the tweets, maybe we can cite some of them before entering the questions. There you go. Governments have to create more equality in education to ensure for revolution benefits everyone. Then Stephanie with the foreign industrial revolution increases inequality in the region, what we were talking, or can make growth more inclusive, that's a question. Salesforce, Maria Martinez says that CEOs at, we are all, how do you see that? Are all scared of being Uberized. So where are the Latin American Ubers? Some of the people that have been tweeting, thanks a lot. We're gonna start 10 minutes of Q&As. Please, sir, can we start here? Very, very brief. And please ask a question, okay?
Quick question.
And to whom?
Yes, this is to Ildefonso. Ildefonso, there are many ecosystems in different countries in Latin America focused on technology, no? In which we have more than, I would say, 100 companies that are being developed in the different countries that we talked about. Would it be possible to have a multinational sovereign fund that would invest in technology companies? So, because you mentioned that the capital markets are not there to foster this growth. So can you create like a pan-regional initiative to foster this growth, similar to what's happened with the Pan-Pacific Alliance?
Yes. Well, I have news for you. It is the case of Alianza Pacifico. We are creating a fund between Colombia, Chile, Peru, and Mexico to really encourage and share risk in venture, like a venture capital. It is not a big chunk. I mean, we are starting with Mexico has already put its share. We are starting with something like 100 million pesos from the Mexican side. Obviously, it's just the beginning of it. And the idea is to use Alianza Pacifico as a launching board to really promote risk capital for venture initiatives in the region.
Another question. I saw someone from here. Oh, please, thanks.
Gracias.
Thank you. This is a question for Minister Luna. Minister, if we look at the rest of our lives, today may be the slowest day of our lives in terms of technological change. If we compare it to tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, education and the law go behind the speed of technology. That is true. But there are some things that are in the Constitution that have nothing to do with free competition, such as copyright law, the right to one's good name, and a series of laws that should have nothing to do with the medium. Traditional print media is forced to subject itself to a series of behaviors and limits that other media don't. That's a very important question. What is the government going to do is the question. And this is part of a debate that I think has ceased in many other latitudes. Look at the recent ruling by our constitutional court about the right to be forgotten, which refers closely to the right to one's good name. And the need in that constitutional ruling for a publishing house through the internet to remove some information from its portals after the judicial ruling. So what does the government do? The government clearly writes in, or rather, clearly works on the constitutional rights, and it enforces constitutional rights, and it protects constitutional rights. Now, the democratic debate in social media or through other platforms has its pros and cons. In our case, we see that we're not only part of that democratic debate, but we also allow it. We tolerate every criticism because we feel that any criticism has a right to be there. However, individuals also have a right to enforce their constitutional rights. They should not only be protected but supported by the government.
Back there, thanks, and then the sir.
Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon. A question open to the panel. I'd like to ask you, how can we rethink the digital gap, knowing that we are going from not connectivity but appropriation? And how do we make it so that this new gap doesn't consume whole societies and whole organizations?
I mean, digital transformation it's also a process. I mean, and it's not just connectivity. It's everything, you know, about getting to understand what is possible with what we have today, but also be able to introduce new technologies. So I think that is very important because it goes to any enterprise level and any person. So right now, in my opinion, is not about who owns the information or who owns the process. It's about how can you make it work, how can you enable that process to be available to everyone or to who is in need of it. So yes, it could be a challenge, but right now is more an opportunity for individuals and organizations to take advantage of it.
I think it's, right. I agree. I think it's all about distribution and access, and including distribution. So access is a philosophy, distribution is a tactic. And so distribution through commercial companies, through schools, through NGOs, through local government, that use the distribution methods that get to everybody, rural, urban, rich, poor, and then laws and regulation and incentive, government incentive that make it affordable for companies to create that kind of distribution, I think is the way you avoid the divide.
Sir, can you help me with this? Thanks.
Yes, I have a question. One of the biggest impacts of the fourth revolution is the disruption in business models. I think that there is an element that is being disrupted, which are borders, national borders as we know them today. So one of my main questions would be, in addition to borders, the business model of the national state financed with taxes in their local operations. So the dissolution of borders and the impact on businesses the biggest victim is governments who have a business model that is fiscal and based on tax collection. So how are governments going to fund themselves, or how do states look at the disruption of their entire fiscal model to finance themselves in a world that will be practically borderless? This question has two parameters, I would say. What is happening today in the digital world has influenced the design and architecture of international commercial treaties. In the case of Mexico, 20 years ago when we signed, or 25 years ago when we signed the NAFTA, it didn't have an electronic commerce clause. We've just signed the Asia-Pacific FTA, and it clearly has an e-trade component. And the fiscal question is very relevant because every state is facing this challenge and is trying to address it. Now, what happens, for example, with the Uber system, that the earnings margin that occurs with Mexican value added isn't paying taxes in Mexican land, and that should be part of a negotiation process with the suppliers and with the platforms in order to be able to anchor and to prevent precisely the fact that the value can't be reinvested in the society that creates it. So in this case, the driver is within the system, the driver that provides the service. However, the great earnings of the platform aren't part of the system. That needs to be relocated, no question. And this is in the interest of the community that is creating the wealth.
Hola.
Hello, Leandro Machado from Brazil. And our democracies are at risk, under pressure, but our political leaders aren't yet part of this discussion. How do, as a society, how do we bring them in to this discussion? Should we send them an Uber or what?
Okay. The individuals, people are going to bring them to the discussion.
Force them.
Sometimes, mm-hmm. but really forward-looking political leaders, two of them on the stage today earlier, will embrace that. Those that don't embrace it will be forced into the conversation because there's no protection vertically anymore. It goes horizontally and then it goes to the top. It'll be forced.
Will you say that Bill Clinton had the vision for the internet in the U.S.? I mean, he was the one that really
Who?
Embraced Bill Clinton.
Bill Clinton.
No, it was a question.
No, I mean, sometimes so just to be clear, I'm not the only, I don't speak for the United States of America, or any political party. I'm unaffiliated, I'm a political independent, I vote both parties. Most Americans haven't voted yet, to be clear. The best thing government can do is create a regulatory framework and a protective framework, whether it's internet, e-commerce, industrialization, digital technology, that allows predictability for the individual. You do that, and society will flourish. And if you try to control or maintain power or hold down mobility, society at some point, sooner or later, will rise up against it.
Last question. And time is over, but I'll have the last question. They allow me. They tell me it's okay.
Hello, Walter Cohen. Maria Martinez from Salesforce mentioned that the enterprises must change and act now because the fourth industrial revolution is unstoppable. If we consider governments as macro enterprises, the governments must change now. The question is, which governments are the best practices in the world regarding this subject? What are the key elements they have changed so far as to be considered best practices? And who are the agents of change or the accelerators that have enabled this government to achieve this best practice place?
And you want the answer in 1 minute?
30 seconds. Maybe Maria or David? Could I ask Maria?
I can't think about one government that I can. I think that there are best practices in a lot of governments. I think that even here, just this week, I've really heard a lot of real good policies that are being put in place by a lot of governments. I think it has to do, at the end of the day, more, it's early, right, in this revolution. So it's, I don't think that the winners have established, even in the public or commercial sector. So I think there's an opportunity for many of us, you know, to show leadership. I think at the end of the day, it's all going to be about leadership. And leadership is what's going to dictate the public or private institutions that will take advantage of this revolution.
Maybe a region, not to say government, yeah, but a region, yeah, that a is region, yes, leading that?
Yeah, a region. Well, I mean, I think, you know, I'm probably biased because US. The U.S., right?
Yeah. Thank you so much. Gracias a todos. Thanks a lot for attending. Brian, Claudia, David, Maria, Ildefonso. It's been a pleasure to be with all of you today. Gracias a ustedes por asistir. Muy amable. Gracias.